with every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, holy, there is no one like. None besides you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you, Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Your
Morning to everyone, and to all of us, or to all of you watching us online, and please prepare yourselves to have this communion. And if you can have your bread and drink ready, and we will celebrate this communion together. It may not be physically together, but we can celebrate it as one in spirit and in truth, so to speak. When Jesus came into this earth, he has his purpose and his mission. The angel, when he announced to Joseph that Mary will give birth to a son, he said this to Joseph, "And you shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." And we all know that all people are sinners. In Romans 3, chapter 3, verse 23, it says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." And in Psalms chapter 14, verses 2 to 3, it says, "The Lord looks down from heaven on all mankind to see if there are any who understand, any who seek God. All have turned away, all have become corrupt. There is no one who does good, not even one." So we can see from the Bible that everyone sins. In fact, the Bible says that when God looks down from heaven, he says everyone does commit sins. No one is good, not even one, it says. In Luke chapter 19, verse 10, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." The Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. When Jesus was here on earth, he reached out and came down to those people considered as sinners during those times. If you remember the story of Zacchaeus, Zacchaeus was a tax collector, a rich guy who collected money from the people as tax. But he took money more than what is required from them and used those money to enrich himself. And yet Jesus came to his house and ate with him together with his disciples. And then as a result, Zacchaeus realized his need for a savior. He realized his situation before God. He realized that he was a sinner. And he repented of his sins and promised to pay back the money to all the people that where he took the money from them. So when Zacchaeus met Jesus, he found the Savior, he repented of his sins, and he came as a new person. Remember the story of Samaritan woman. The Samaritan woman who had 5 husbands. And the story says, and the latest man she was with was in fact not her husband. She was an adulterous woman. And yet Jesus reached out to him or to her and showed her the salvation. And also remember Jesus while he was hanging on the cross, agonizing the pain and the shame that came with hanging on that cross. Yet when one of the robbers who were hung with him repented of his sins and asked him to remember him in paradise, Jesus right away assured him of his salvation and said to him, "Today I tell you, you will be with me in paradise." Jesus came to seek and to save the lost, in which we are one of those people. God gave us the Ten Commandments, which is the moral law. We all broke the law, and Jesus paid the fine. So His purpose of coming here is to seek and to save those people and be their Savior. You shall call His name Jesus, for He shall save His people from their sins. His mission. In John chapter 19, verse 30, it says, "It is finished." While He was hanging on the cross, Jesus said this, "It is finished." He said this with a loud voice. Not that He is finished and done, as if He had lost it and was defeated in His mission, but that He said it is finished with a loud voice, signifying that He was victorious in His mission, that the penalty of sins had been paid for, and victory over death had been achieved. His purpose in coming as a man has been performed, and His mission of paying our fine is finished, or is accomplished. And now we will thank Him, or we should thank Him, for that cross. Thank You, Lord Jesus, for dying on the cross in our behalf. If we can have our bread and drink ready, and we will pray for the element. Let us pray for the element. Thank You, Lord Jesus, for once again speaking to us and reminding us that we should be always be faithful to You in all Your commands, even as You have commanded us to remember Your death on the cross. Lord, we thank You for dying on that cross of Calvary. We thank You, Lord, for You have paid the penalty. You bore the penalty of our sins on the cross. And by Your blood, we are washed. By Your blood, we are cleansed. And thank You, Lord, for You gave Yourself willingly to be a sacrifice for us, to give us eternal life. Lord, as we remember Your death, what You have done on the cross, we pray for this element, the bread and the wine, representing Your body and Your blood that was shed on the cross of Calvary. We bless You, O Lord. We thank You. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 to 26, it says, "For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took bread. And when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, 'This is My body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of Me.' In the same way, after supper, He took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in My blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of Me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes.'" Let us all eat of the bread and drink of the wine. Let us all thank the Lord, praise Him for His holy, praise Him for He is our Lord and Savior of our lives. Give glory to God. Amen. Amen.
Hi everybody, welcome to our broadcast today of the message from the church, Melton Christian Church. It's great to have you here today, and I would trust that everything's going well and that you're in good spirits. And as I share today, I just want to encourage you. I'm just focusing on the reality of what our purpose is. What is your purpose? We have been created by God for a purpose. A purpose that extends further than this life. That we can be an influence for God for his kingdom. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things shall be given to you as well. But seek the kingdom. And are we effective in the kingdom? I believe that God wants everyone to be effective in his kingdom, to have a purpose, to have a role. No matter what you do in life, in a worldly sense, how successful you are, how much you achieve on this earth, unless it is related to God's kingdom, in the final event, it will have no value in eternity. It will be in vain. But God has a plan even for you today. It doesn't matter who you are, how old you are, what talents you have or what talents you don't have, or what you don't think you have, God wants you to be effective in his kingdom. Today I want to look at two characters in the Bible that are opposites. One, both have a word from God for a city. One of them is reluctant in sharing the message, and that is Jonah. I want to talk about Jonah, and I want to talk about Paul. Okay? Jonah is a reluctant prophet. He has a word from God to go to Nineveh and to tell the people that if they don't repent or if they don't change their ways, that God's going to destroy their city. And Jonah, in his mind, has got it that because God is such a great God that if he won't destroy that city if they repent. And he doesn't like these people, and he doesn't want them to be blessed, and he doesn't want them to be forgiven. So he's got a task to go to Nineveh, which is this way, and he goes that way to Tarshish. What he does is he goes onto a boat or a ship, and on his way, the opposite direction to what God asked him to go. And on the way, he's in this ship, and God brings a massive storm. And the storm is so bad that even the crew on the ship and the captain are fearing for their life. And so they say amongst themselves that it must be the God of one of us, our gods, is angry with us and has caused this. And so therefore, you know the story. Jonah is down the bottom in the ship, sleeping. The crew is frantically trying to offload stuff to try to make it stable, the ship. And they've come to a point where they've said, we've got to do something. It's got to be somebody here that has created this. Their God is angry. So he said, the Bible says they cast lots, and the lots fell on Jonah. And he's down the bottom in the ship sleeping. And the captain comes up to me and says, what are you doing? What have you done? He'd already told them beforehand that he'd been running away from God. And he says, what's the solution? And he said, well, I'm the cause of this. Okay, I'm the cause. The best solution is throw me overboard. They didn't want to do that. But finally, they throw him overboard. You know the story. And God prepares a fish, a large fish. And he's swallowed up by the fish. And he's in the fish for 3.5 days, or 3 days and three nights. And after that, he has an encounter with God, and the fish spews him or vomits him out of his mouth, and he finishes up on the shore. And God challenges him again, go to Nineveh and tell the people of Nineveh. So reluctantly, after having his life saved, he goes to Nineveh and he tells the people of Nineveh that God's going to destroy their city unless they turn from their evil ways. And the people are responding to the word, the message that he has. Even the king responds to the message and they all repent. And I just want to read a scripture. The first scripture I want to read, the first verse I want to read is in Jonah chapter 3 and verse 10. It says, when God saw that what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction he had threatened. And what was Jonah's response? In chapter 4 and verse 1 to 4, it says, But to Jonah, this seemed very wrong. And he became angry and he prayed to the Lord. Isn't this what I said, Lord, when I was still at home? That is what I tried to foretell by fleeing to Tarshish. I knew that you were a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger, abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. Now, Lord, take my life. For it's better for me to die than to live. But the Lord replied, is it right for you to be angry? Jonah was mad with God. He hated these people. He didn't want God to bless them. He didn't want them to forgive them. He wanted them to destroy that city. Wow. What an attitude. Do you have people that you know that you don't want God's blessing on, that you don't want God to forgive? Our hearts, what's our hearts towards our fellow man? To different people in different places, what's our response? Do we have a heart of love for all people? God's instruction to us is to love everybody, even our enemies. I want to have a look at another character. We just had a look at Jonah and his heart. His heart wasn't good towards people. But I want to have a look at Paul. He's also got a message for a city. But he's also heading in the wrong direction. So God has a plan for him to share to a city. And in his mind, he wants to go in one way and the Lord's not letting him go in that direction. I want to have a look at a passage of scripture in Acts chapter 16. You may be familiar with this passage of scripture. Paul and his companions traveling through the region of Pergama and Galatia have been kept by the Holy Spirit from preaching the word in the province of Asia. So the Holy Spirit stops them from preaching where they're intending to go. When they came to the border of Mysia and they tried to enter Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus would not let them go. So he passed by Mysia and went down to Troas. During the night, Paul had a vision of a man in Macedonia standing and begging, come over to Macedonia and help us. After Paul had seen the vision, he got ready at once to leave for Macedonia, concluding that the God had called him to preach the gospel to them. Paul believed that he should go back. This is his second missionary trip. He thought, what I've got to do is go back to where I've been and encourage the people where we've been and the churches that have been set up. But God had another idea. He was sensitive to the Holy Spirit. He wanted to do what God wanted him to do. Unlike Jonah. I know Jonah didn't want to do what God asked him to do. But Paul wants to do what God wants him to do. And so therefore he goes into Macedonia and he plants the church in Philippi. Philippi is probably a lower socioeconomic area in the region, and Paul establishes a church, and Paul's blessing is upon him because of the church plant that he planted there. The Philippian people, he becomes very close to them. And so there, and Paul is there, and he plants the church, and he finds favor with these people. We find that if we read the scriptures, that God blessed Paul through the people in Philippi more than any others. They supported him financially. They encouraged, they even brought different members of their church going there to support the ministry through different times. And God and Paul really was really blessed by these people. By being obedient to God, God's blessing was upon the people, but upon himself as well. So the thing is, when we hear from God, no matter where we need to go or what God wants us to do, the only thing that comes from it is blessing. Okay, so on one hand, we have one person who has a message for a city, and he doesn't want to share that message. On the other hand, we have Paul, who has a message for the city, and God's blessing goes forward, and he just wants to do what God's will is. And he's pliable in God's hand. You know, he wants to go this way, and even though the thing's not working the way he wanted to go, the Holy Spirit speaks into his heart, and then he gives a vision. God, what is your situation today? Are you so steadfast on your direction in your life that God can't change it? Or are you sensitive to God? Are you able to hear his voice? Are you being able to be led by the Holy Spirit and to do the things that he wants you to do? You know, God has a call on our life. God has a plan for our life. He wants to use us for his kingdom, for his blessing upon other people. God wants to bless people through you. Do you know that? You can bless people by being obedient to God. Are you going in the wrong direction that God wants you to do? Go. I'm not talking, I'm talking figuratively, okay? God has a plan for you, has a mission for you to extend his kingdom on the earth. How many people has God given in your life for you to have influence over, to be able to encourage, to bless, to speak into their life, to be able to share the gospel with? Maybe sometimes we're not even aware of the ones that God wants us to do that. But God has people that he wants you to speak into their life. Don't look at what you can't do. You know, so often you say, well, it's not my gifting. I can't do that. I'm not good with words. A little bit like Moses. Remember Moses? God asked him, I want you to go to Pharaoh. He said, oh, I can't go. He said, I can't speak properly. You know, I'm not fluent in my speaking. And God had other ideas for his life. You know, God used Moses in a powerful, mighty way because he ultimately responded and said, okay, at the end. He tried to use every excuse why he shouldn't be the person God would use, and God used him mightily. We're like that sometimes, aren't we? You know, we think, all the reasons. You know, like, send so-and-so. Yeah, that's what Paul said. That's what Moses said. Go and send somebody else. No, God has a plan for you. And I just want to encourage you that God wants to use you. The Bible says, many are called, but few are chosen. We are called to be effective within the kingdom of God. Sometimes we don't know exactly what God wants us to do, but God has a plan for us. He just wants us to be attentive to his voice, listen to what God is saying. There are people that we can encourage, that we can bless. Sometimes we've got to get out of our way, out of our comfort zone. You know? We don't always know the type of people that God wants us to speak into their life. I want to give you an illustration I've given it before, but it's an illustration of the construction of a skyscraper or a large building, okay? And the builder and the architect, together with a project manager, are going through this building. And they're coming up to this guy that's he's doing some plumbing work. He's working on an ensuite, you know, and he's looking at the vanity and the toilet. And they go up to the guy, and the architect says, "What are you doing?" He said, "I'm actually putting these pipes and making sure that the water flows properly when it's discharged." Wow, good. And they go a little bit further, and they see a guy hammering away as a carpenter, and he's doing a bit of work around the door frame, and he's just fixing the door frame up. And he said to him, "How's it going there?" He said, "Oh, fine, all's good." He said, "What are you doing?" He said, "I'm just putting this architrave around the door, you know, just to finalize it." Wow, that's good, great. And then he comes up to another guy, he's working in the hallway, and he's doing a little bit of patch-up work, and he's doing a cleaning job. And they go up to him, and the builder says, "What are you doing?" He said, "I'm building a cathedral. I'm building this massive building." What are we doing? Are we doing some job? Or we are part of building God's kingdom. You know, it doesn't matter what we're doing as part of God's kingdom. We're building his kingdom. We're extending his kingdom. We might think it's only one little job and we're only focused on this one little thing. But God is, he's saying, "I've got a purpose to build his kingdom." You know, Paul, when he started, I know he initially was persecuting the church, but when he first got saved, he started going around sharing the gospel with whoever he could. In fact, they didn't understand why, what he was doing, but he began just by sharing the gospel with people. You know, and then he went away for a time, and when he came back, he was with Barnabas, and he joined Barnabas in a missionary trip. And the Bible says that he supported Barnabas in his missionary trip. A little bit further, we read in the scripture, we find that it was Paul and Barnabas. And this time it was Paul who was leading and Barnabas was doing. And later on, we find that Paul, he built a team around him and he went out preaching the gospel and starting churches. So he began from small things until finally he became big. You know, some people, all they want to do is stuff in the kingdom as long as it's big. You know, I want to be the main person. But God is saying with us that if we're faithful in the little things, God will enable us to be faithful in much. You know, God wants you to be faithful in little things, to begin. You know what I mean? It's in the natural, you know, you don't start off as being the CEO of a company, okay? You start by working your way through. And it's the same with the kingdom of God. You know, we all start in doing the smaller things. And when we're faithful in the smaller thing, God enables us to be able to do more. That's what God's plan for you and for I, that we can be effective in the kingdom, no matter what it is, whether it's little or whether it's large. God wants us to have a heart for people, all people, not selective people, all people. God will bring people across our path, and God wants us to bless them. God wants us to speak into their life. What gifting have you got? Are you a good encourager? You know, in part of the teaching of Paul in the book of Romans, he says, you know, like, and he talks about the different things, that if you've got a gift of encouraging, go and encourage. If you have a gift of mercy, show mercy. If you have a gift of leading, you lead. Whatever the gift is, we do it, okay? And so God's given us gifts. He's given us talents. He's given us these things for a purpose, okay? It's so easy to lose sight and get involved in everything around about us that we lose sight of the kingdom. We're so busy building our own little thing or big thing, depending on what you're doing, but it is worldly. It is only temporary. It has no eternal value. The only thing that has any eternal value is the kingdom. The kingdom of God is eternal. You know? The only thing you're going to take into heaven with you is what you sow into another life. The only thing that's going to have any eternal value is what you pour into somebody as far as God is concerned. Okay? Natural things are good, and particularly if God is asking you to do something like that, feeding the poor or sharing with somebody or whatever it is, that's great. Praise God. God has a plan for your life. What is the meaning of your life? Are you fulfilling the purpose? I want to say again, God has a plan for you. He has created you to enhance his kingdom. We're being called by God to make a difference. Whose life can you bless? In whose life can you make a difference? Maybe it's supporting something. Whatever it is, we need to be sensitive to what the Holy Spirit is saying. You know, as a church, we want to be able to bless. We want to be able to share with people. We want to be able to be the people that God wants us to be that will touch the lives of others. You know, God's given us a vision to reach out in a new way. Thank you for the opportunity to share this morning. I hope that today that you've been challenged in some way. You might say, well, I don't have much to give. You know, I don't have a lot. I believe if we're sensitive to what God is saying and use the opportunities around us and encourage somebody and speak a word here and a word there, it will make a difference. God has his way of opening the door. What does he say? If you are faithful in little things, I will enable you to be faithful in much. Bless God. Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for this new day you've given to each one of us. Lord, I pray that you would, Lord, just speak into our hearts. Lord, that we would listen to that small, still voice. Lord, that we would know, Lord God, the word that you're saying to us. Lord, that we can be a source of blessing and encouragement to those around about us, Lord God, that we could speak a word in season into a person's life. Lord, that we'd be so open to you speaking into our life that we would know without a doubt. And Lord, if we're heading in the wrong direction, Lord God, we pray that you would show us clearly. Lord, even a vision as what Paul received. Lord, that you would show us, Lord, the direction you want us to go. And Lord, that we wouldn't run away from it, Lord God, that we wouldn't, as we're quickened, even like Jonah was told where to go, and that we wouldn't turn our backs on it, Lord God, and say, well, that can't be God. You know, that can't be God. Yes, God moves in different ways. So, Father, I thank you for your goodness. I pray a blessing upon everyone, Lord, that's watching this telecast today, that your hand would be upon them, that you would guide and direct them. Lord, that they'd be a source of blessing for your kingdom. Lord, that your kingdom would grow. Lord, because we are all together working together with you. Because we know, Lord God, that Jesus is building the church. But Lord, you're using individuals to do all the little bits and pieces. Lord, the same as that guy in that building, Lord God, where he was only just touching up a little bit and cleaning up. Lord, but that is effective for the overall benefit of that building that was being built. So, Father, we see you, that you're building a building. And, Lord, we thank you, Lord God, that we can be part of what you're doing. Father, I pray a blessing on everyone in Jesus' name. Amen.